down. When you calculate the trading cost, it requires so many variables, so many indicators. If your cost of trading is going down, that means it is profitable for both of us. It is good for both of us. Because when I calculated the trading cost between India and Central Asia, it's a huge one. India and Central Asia doesn't have direct connectivity. It has to be traveled, product has to be traveled by ship through Iran, through Pakistan, and through China. These are the three ports through which we facilitate our export movement to the Central Asian republics, and it has a huge cost. But the cost, India's trading cost with Central Asian republics is minimum through the China. China is the shortest route and also cheapest. So it is the advantage of understanding that our trade cost is declining. That means we are in the positive mode of doing business. India's look and act policy is reciprocated by many ASEAN countries. Since 2002, India is having annual summit with ASEAN and signed the initials of ASEAN-India free trade in 2003. So everything is moving on our perspective. Whatever we feel as a researcher, it is going smoothly. When negotiations take place, it takes time to finalize, because both of the country has to think and take into consideration of all the stakeholders. Somebody is not happy with this industry, somebody is not happy with that industry. So everybody has to be happy before we finalize the free trade agreement. India-Thailand trade is very, very limited as compared to other parts of the world. This is one of the challenges which we have to address through both the country-to-country negotiation. Thailand is the second largest economy in the ASEAN region and the greater Mekong sub-region. This is the second largest economy. It is an upper middle income country, upper middle, with a gross domestic product of around 400 billion in 2015. The growth of the GDP in Thailand has averaged between 3 to 4% in the last decade. India's economic and commercial relationship with Thailand are rooted in history, which we have already discussed. India and Thailand is regulated by two policies, which we have discussed. So what is the total trade value between these two countries? It is less than $10 billion. It is less than $10 billion since last at least one decade. It is varying from 4 to 8 only. It never ever crossed $8 billion. So we have to work very hard to improve our trade value, because 800 billion is nothing in the global market. We have potential to become at least $25 billion by 2025, then $50 billion by 2035. We have to set the target. Unless or until we do not set target, we cannot achieve that. Since date, I have not seen any documents where India and Thailand had set a target to achieve 10 billion by 2020 even. As an economist or as a researcher, we generally project. There is a modeling to project. There is no any literature available. There is no any literature. If you set a target that India-Thailand trade will be 10 billion by 2020 after 3 years, it is good achievement. But nobody wants to do it. I am going to project what will be the trade volume by 2020 and 2025 after 5 year interval. And later I will give you the policy recommendations, how you will achieve. Then only 5.2 billion exports and 2.63 billion import. This is the total figure. I am not happy as a researcher to read this figure. I want at least $20 billion between these two countries by 2020. not 10 billion, 20 billion. There is a potential to become 20 billion trading partner between the two countries, and then you can set a target. So Thailand ranks as India's fourth largest trading partner after Singapore, Indonesia and Malaysia. Number is topping everywhere, but figure is not improving anywhere. This is the problem and challenges which we are facing these days. The growing ties between the two countries have come at a time when the AEC is expected to bring greater integration among the members in the region and physical connectivity, economic links and culture and educational ties. Now I expect that our India-Thailand trade volume will be more than 15 billion by 2025, because we are going to enroute our trade through Asian Highway and trilateral highway, Thailand, Myanmar and India. I am very much optimistic that our trade will be at least 15 billion by 2025. Let us see what will be the prevailing situation, because we have given a level playing field to the global economy that this route is already functional and operational in 2016. Let us hope by 8 years our trade will be at least doubled. So within 8 years it will be going to be doubled. Then we have a policy that is early harvest scheme covering 82 products, now 83 products under the proposed India-Thailand free trade agreement in place since 2014, has already resulted in a phenomenal growth in our bilateral country. So policy initiative we have already taken. Now this is the time to implement on the ground and look that our trade will be 15 billion by 2025. This is the figure of India-Thailand trade last 6 years. Total trade is around maximum 8.87 billion in 2012, which is declining and sometime increasing. So it is a fluctuating. Fluctuation is good for the bilateral relationship, but fluctuation should be 1 to 3 years, not every year. Every year is having some problems. It is like a conflict and peace. Peace and conflict. You are suffering from violence, then your relationship will be declined. If you are in peace, you will promote your commodity. So our relationship has to be built up through this figure, that this is the challenge. We will accept the challenge that, oh, we have done it. But now this is the time to improve the bilateral trading relationship. So by 2025, it can be $15 billion. The major imports from India are following sector: machinery and parts, crude oil, electronic machinery. These are available in the literature. There is no need to go in detail. Thailand major exports commodity to India are in the same: motor, cars, parts, accessory, automatic data processing, polymakers, jewelry, ethylene, electronic. These are the things which is exported to India, and it is very much evident whenever I go to shopping malls and travel to the Thailand area, Bangkok area, it is evident that your product is dominated by this commodity and which is exportable item also. Now the second challenge before us is to understand our investment connection. How we trust each other in terms of the foreign direct investment. In 2012, approved Indian investment in Thailand was merely $196 million, and in 2015 it is very, very less. Approved Thailand investment in India was almost increasing, but in 2013 it was very, very high. So in terms of investment, it can be happened. There will be bulk of investment at one point of time, and there will be less investment at second point of time, because investment attracts a lot of other things also. You cannot set a industry each and every day. Once you set a industry, it will be remain for 100 years or 500 years. So there is a not problem in terms of investment, because once you establish a industry or invest in a particular country, it will remain be profitable for both of them. It keep generating employment for both the country, and it keep attracting the consumer also, and also promoting the trade. Trade generating joint ventures, it is good for country. But I am not commenting on this. Since our investment is very, very low at this stage, we need more Indian businessmen in Thailand and more Thai business in India to establish at least visible relationship. I call it visible because difficult to see Thai business in India. It is located in the pockets, nobody knows about it. Everybody knows about Japan investment, Korea investment, China investment, Japan investment, USA investment, Germany investment, Thailand, nobody knows. If you ask any researcher of economics in India, where is Thai investment? I have never ever seen. It has to be visible. It has to be educated to the people that, oh, Thai presence in our economy is very, very visible. And I will give you who are the investors in India and who are the investors in Thailand. So, major Thai companies active in India are, these are the major active companies in India are, these are the 20 companies who is active but nobody knows. That means their share in investment is very, very less. It is not reachable to the local people in India. Then Thailand foreign direct investment in 2015 is, this is the figure, the total attracted investment in Thailand is $3,049 million. This is the total investment by 2015, and ASEAN constitute 1,007, Japan 872, China 357, USA 200, European Union 128, and India is not visible in the graph. It is only located by the figure. So India is nowhere in Thailand when it comes for investment. We can only write 4, which is visible, but graph it is missing. It is a thin line. Thin line is represented by India. Being an Indian, I am very, very disappointed. I want to see at least some colorful graph, but it is only thick line. But doesn't matter, our relationship has already been started to boom. Let us see by next year, by 10 years, it will be visible. And trends in Indian applications for the foreign direct investment in Thailand. Thailand government has attracted Indian applications, and the number is very, very impressive. As I tell you, in 2009 it was $130 million investment, but in 2014 it is only 69. So investment, there is no any problem, it can fluctuate. But the number of projects is also very interesting. It is increasing and increasing every year except this 2010 and 2011. So this is the 2 years where it was very, very less, but in 2014 it is again 22 number of investors in the Thai economy. So Indian investment application is attracted by 4-5 major sectors: agricultural products, copper wire rod, copper wire bar and coil center, services, chemicals and paper, electronic and electronic products. So these are the information given by the Board of Investment of Thailand, which I incorporated in my presentation. Air connectivity between India and Thailand is growing with 150 flights per week, reflecting a rapidly growing traffic of tourists and business persons between the two nations. All major airlines of India operates between the two countries: Air India, Jet Airways, SpiceJet, Thai Airways, Bangkok Airways, Air Asia and IndiGo. So there is no problem in terms of the air connectivity, but destination is a problem. We do not have any direct flight from Bangkok to Tawang, that is Arunachal Pradesh, Itanagar, Aizawl and Guwahati. It is only connected by Delhi and Calcutta and Lucknow. Lucknow is a third destination for direct flight. So these are the things one can understand as a policy decision maker. I am very happy to see that India Thai Joint Commission, already headed by the foreign ministries, I'll also a well established India Thai Chamber of Commerce and Active India Thai Business Association. A joint business policy has already been set up in 2013 with the involvement of the private sector to stimulate expansion of bilateral trade and investment and facilitate business partnership. So our policy framework is on route. It is required only channelized. So we will be channelized within coming decades. So these are the three trade agreements signed by India. I will not go in detail. You know what? You see, this is the. It took me a lot of time to generate, not for this presentation, but earlier presentation when I was working with Central Asia Republics. So when you see, this is the six republics: Russia, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, and China. How infrastructure development can promote or integrate two economy and more than two economy at the minimum time frame. This is the example. So it is better to understand the world perspective, how they are doing their business, why our trade is not even $10 billion till date, and our relationship is 2000 years old. You know, there is a lot of differences between the two statements. If you have 2000 year old relationship and your trade is only $10 billion, so there is a mismatch. Either there is a problem in our relationship that we never ever have a good friendship, or we have an enemy relationship. So a good relationship or bad relationship indicates.
But that is more cultural connection.
That is why exactly, sir. This is the problem. Our trade is dominated by cultural, traditional relationship. If our food is same, our hobby is same, our diet is same, our culture is same, Ramayana is same, where is the problem? Once you go to, you know, Sikkim, you will find Thai restaurant. Forget Thai restaurant, Thai food is in every hotel. So I do not see any difference between Thai food in Sikkim and in Bangkok. I enjoy both the places. So your people is very, very similar in Northeast India than in rest of the country. But you never ever recognize Northeast India as your own people. Face is common, dress is common, living style is common, behavior is common, everything is common. People will easily mixed up. But government is not open-hearted to connect with Northeast India to rest of the world. These are the problems with new government has started to understand, and our Honorable Prime Minister has a very open mind that let us promote Northeast India as a focus priority area. So when you see that Western Europe and Western China infrastructure development building, then we will be basically surprised how they have developed. This is the network of transport. I visited some of the transport network, how they have built up the infrastructure at each and every state with location installment machine. Your track is moving from one station to another station. Everybody knows that, oh, your track is going from this way to that way. You cannot smuggle illegal goods to control the illegal goods, because when we talk about Asian highway, when we talk about trilateral highway, smuggling of products comes as a challenge, as a security problem. Common border patrolling will come as a challenge. How we will manage our transport movement, people movement, drug trafficking, human trafficking. So once you set your infrastructure in the beginning, that you can have check and balance over movement of each and every things, there is no any challenge and risk. It will be automatically rectified that, oh, you have taken another person in the truck while going from this border to that border. Police will automatically catch them. Who is this fellow? You are not supposed to enter in the vehicle. Why you have entered? So it is a check balance through the device, which is developed also in Afghanistan-Pakistan transit train route. It is already in the place. So challenges will be remain the same, but we have to at least think about this model of infrastructure building. International Transport Logistics Center is the red one. You see how many red points are there throughout the channel. Communicator, they will communicate each other. Though this person is entered in a new car, you know, in a truck, catch them, put them in behind the bar. There is no any mercy. Operators, who are the operators? Communication center, base station of trunking communication. So each and every infrastructure has already built up in the Western Europe and Western China. International Transit Corridor, it is good for us to implement all those provisions in the Asian Highway or Trilateral Highway before we face any challenges. So India-Thailand cooperate each other through regional and bilateral and sub-regional approach. I will not go into detail. These are the econometrics modeling done by me as a researcher, because I cannot tell anything without testing through the model. Social science people take, but I do not believe unless or until I test myself that, oh, this is correct figure. So when we talk about trade openness ratio, then both the country is improving, but India is less than Thailand. Trade is more open than India. This is potential where we have to tap. How one country is opened up their trade as compared to the big country, we call it big because is India is a huge population, populated country. So these are the one. And when we talk about diversification, whether our commodity is diversified in the trading basket or not, let us see both the country both the country status. Number of product we are trading, India 241, Thailand 242. Okay, concentration index is 0.138. It is very, very lowest. The concentration index range is 0 to 1. So if it is not up to 1, that means we are very, very, very lower stage of the concentration. India is, Thailand is even less, 0.090. This is the concentration. And when we talk about diversification, India is moving at least more than 0.5, and Thailand is still to achieve 0.5. But in 2015, they have done better, but number of commodities, concentration index is declined for both the country, India and Thailand. Diversification index is also declined for both the country. That means our concentration is still dominated in a limited number of products. We have not yet able to diversify our trading basket in 2015, both the country, India and Thailand. Now, this is the time to diversify our product, maximize the number of trading commodities, to increase the level of trading between these two countries, which will automatically go beyond 8 billion. In terms of imports basket, the same situation, concentration index is 0.1 and 0.07, and diversification index is still less than 0.5. In 2015, product is increased, but very, very less, only 8 products and 7 products in both the side. So this is the one challenge which we have to diversify our product in the trading basket to maximize the potential which is existing between the two countries. Foreign direct investment, when we take from the international figure, I have given you the country figure. Now this is the international figure. In terms of international figure, India and Thailand, global investment is increasing both sides. But you see, in 2070, this is, I have given figure of 1970 and 2015, 10 years gap and then annual. So figure is quite impressive. I was shocked at looking at the India-Thailand investment. So I thought it is better to make some impressive slides that people should feel happy that, oh, our investment value is this much. We cannot disappoint our audience. So this is the impressive data to attract only audience, satisfy them, but problem will be remain the same. This is the foreign direct investment of ASEAN region. Still, Thailand is very, very, not less, but at least 3rd or 4th position within the ASEAN in the both way. So complementarity is the another model or index through which we understand whether India is complementing Thailand or Thailand is complementing India in terms of trading baskets. If both the countries complement each other, then there is a huge potential. And this potential can be measured at three stages. The three stages is low potential, moderate potential, and high potential. Our trading relationship between India and Thailand is based on moderate potential. It has not yet reached a high potential, which this result shows that it is 0.5 and 0.5. The range is 0.5 to 0.75 for moderate, and high potential will be 0.75 to 1, maximum 1. This is the value between, you know, range of the index. So at least trade complementarity index satisfied my calculation that both of them are enjoying moderate potential, at least relationship, not the poor one, that is the lowest. Tariff rate is very, very high between both the countries. You can see the yellow figure. There is need to reduce the tariff structure, though we are going to sign FTA. And logistics performance index is also satisfactory when we see both the country. Overall logistics performance score is 3.4 and 3.26 for Thailand. Since Thailand is located in ASEAN and India is located in South Asia, it is very, very minuscule difference between the two. Overall LPI rank is also impressive for Thailand, 45 and 35 for India. Timeline which we are taking is India is taking 42 days to trade a container from one place to another place, but Thailand is taking 52 days to send a container from Thailand to rest of the world. So this timeline and tracking and tracing, I was speaking about tracking and tracing, is still very, very less in both the country. So you see, this is the situation when you trade your products through sea route. Distance is 400, you know, day 4. This shows that if your container is stand in a port for one day, you have to pay additional $100. This is the problems which you do not know. As an economist should know, if your jam traffic is not only in the main road or train or a sky train or air, traffic is also in the sea route. So if your container is one day late, you are paying $100 for waiting charge. Waiting charge is $100. So if it goes from wait at the border crossing, charges, changes, transport mode. So there are 4 stages of the waiting place where your cost will be multiplied by this much. Ultimately, the product which will reach to the destination will added this transportation cost and difficult to get profit by the businessman. So unless or until you will not facilitate the smooth movement in the transport by sea route, there will be problem of profits which nobody wants to lose. So this is the things which you can understand from this. How they are waiting. They are waiting to go. They are waiting to go forward, all these ships, but they are not allowed due to the heavy traffic. So system has to be improved. Now I will take few minutes more to understand Northeast India and ASEAN, particularly Thailand relationship. Enhancing connectivity as a strategic priority for both the government, that is India and ASEAN. I have taken connectivity as a separate together because this is the most strategic priority for both India and ASEAN. It consists of risk, security, and also movement of the illegal goods and human trafficking. So these are the strategic priority for both the countries have been declared by our foreign minister, Srimati Sushma Swaraj. This is Sushma Swaraj, our foreign minister. This is the location of Northeast India. West Bengal is the yellow one, which is the hub and becoming a major trading portion of the, you know, connecting to Northeast India. Sikkim is the green one, very close to Himalaya. And then you can see other states. And the next slide you can see China is very close to Sikkim. It is only 51 kilometers far from Gangtok, where I work. You can go and come back every day two times. You can see the border, shake the hands with Chinese force, come back. This is the advantage. Huh? This is the advantage of living at border. So I am looking Northeast India from a border economy, not as a general economy. Border economy has a distinct feature itself, which cannot be comparable with the local or other side. One side is China, second side is Myanmar, and third side is Bangladesh. This is the strategic location of Northeast India. If Thailand send their products in Northeast India, it can easily be transported to Bangladesh, China, and Myanmar. This is the advantage of trading with Northeast India. What is the strength of Northeast India? It is rich in mineral and water resources. Land is very, very fertile. Mountains, terrain, high literacy rate. This is peculiarity. As an Indian, I am telling you, the literacy rate is very, very high in Northeast India. The speaking English speaking people are very, very high. But great potential for tourism is also available. Literacy rate is very, very high as compared to average of the country, average literacy rate. The seven sisters, we call Northeast India as a seven sisters, excluding Sikkim, because Sikkim joined Northeast India region only after 1975. Earlier it was under the kingdom, Chogyal government, Chogyal kingdom. Now it is an independent and sovereign states of India, accessed by the Indian government. So, seven sisters' main resources are tea-based economy, bamboo products, natural gas, silk, oil, handicraft, abundant forest, flora and fauna, great land for growing plantation crops, fruits, vegetables, and natural beauty. And this is also natural herbs, what you call medicinal plants. Medicinal plants, all the northeastern states is full of. All the European Union and people are working there. Resource profile is mineral resources. It is very rich in terms of mineral resources. Northeast India represents a wide spectrum with a host of mineral deposits, among which oil and natural gas has been commercially exploited. These are the agricultural products which I will not discuss in detail. This is the highway, you know, this is the Northeast India. The reality is look east and look at policy literally could mean, what could mean? That is the India, and then it connects not only to Russia, but it connects with Central Asia. This is rest of the world. It is not connecting. It is connecting with ASEAN country. This is the advantage of being look at policy and look at policy. And this is the ASEAN country. This is by design to understand that it is not for the other region, but it is for the ASEAN. So for such a flow of trade benefit, the northeastern states are merely transit based. Because border has a different economy. Transit states are basically, or transit based economy has potential to earn more money without investing. It is a zero investment game. You are simply allowing other country to send your products to third country and getting revenue generation without investing single rupee. This is the transit economy. So transit country doesn't invest any single rupee, but they get huge amount to only allow these goods or containers to pass from your country. So at a transit base, this Northeast India can get huge revenue generations, which can be utilized for developmental process. How advantageous it for the durable prosperity of Northeastern states? Then we have already discussed trust area for investment in Northeast India are identified. Road and inland waterway, air infrastructure and connectivity, power, that is hydro and electricity, tourism, cultural and eco-tourism, food processing, horticulture, bamboo and mineral wise. So this is the area for cooperation in Thailand. What Thailand can offer for Northeastern businessmen? Several new parks is under construction in the Northeastern. Jute Park, Tea Park, IT Park, and investors are welcome to invest in Northeast India. This is the connectivity. Connectivity, I will state, go to the India-Myanmar Thailand Trilateral Highway. It is already functional and it will be a boom for the Northeastern states of India and Thailand to maximize their potential benefit. These are the routes which I will not discuss. You see, India-Myanmar Thailand Trilateral Highway route description is this, and you see the location, how these three countries, one from Moray is in Mizoram state, border of India-Myanmar, then it will come to Mandalay, and then it will come to Yangon, and then it comes to Bangkok through Mysore port. So this is the traffic movement taking place on the Asian highway or trilateral highway, which anybody can understand what will be the future of 2025. I hopeful that our trade basket will be diversified as well as our value will be increased. This is the Kaladan multinodal transit transport facility is already working. This is the Uttar Pradesh and Thailand. This is the Asian highway is going to connect Uttar Pradesh and Thailand, and Thailand government has already started to operate one flight from Bangkok to Lucknow. This is the complementing this Asian highway through airway, and this is the entire location of the Asian highway from one country to another country. And there is a 30 country to involve in this business. So what I am going to sum up with, the government of Northeastern states of India is committed towards facilitating and creating a long-term business relationship with Thailand and to transform the region into a corridor for Southeast Asia and the rest of the India. This is the potential for Northeast India and locational advantage. So what I will conclude with some observations, that there is a need to abolish or reduce the existing information gap. Indian businessmen have not yet fully explored, it is Thailand, not Tajikistan, market due to lack of awareness, that is the information and problem of the transportation. There is a still existing high tariff and non-tariff barrier, at least on the selected product of export interest to the both the country, prevailing logistical infrastructure for serving the needs of the expansion of bilateral trade and investment is highly inadequate. Business contract between both countries are at low and erratic level. There is a need to urgently accelerate this process, and there is a scope for joint collaborations between the two countries in the field of agribusiness, agriculture, knowledge sector, infrastructure, dairy development, pharmaceutical, IT, tourism, leather and Kashmiri industry and solar energy. what are the priority area through we can tap them and tap potential. This is already done. So trade between concluding observation is merely 5. Trade between India and Thailand is increasing, but below the existing potential, which need to set a target and achieve it. Without setting a target, we never ever achieve. So let us set a target that by 2025, our trade will be $15 billion. Let us start to work. How we will achieve this 15 billion? India-Thailand trade and investment cooperation, even though advancing, are much below their potential. There are large number of products or sectors having huge potential to establish trade generating joint ventures between India, especially northeastern part of the country, and Thailand. There is a need to enhance cooperation at production level and export oriented and import substitution oriented, and establish a joint marketing strategy. We do not have joint marketing strategy. Everybody feels that there will be some copy and paste, so they hesitate in doing this. So joint marketing strategy or network is the need of the time to boost trade and investment cooperation. And last is synergize partnership, especially at the business enterprises for forging trade and investment linkages to realize existing potential. This is the conclusion as per my observations and knowledge about this topic. So thank you very much for your kind attention, and these are the things which I will share with you within 1 minute. We are working very hard to get maximum benefit from the Asian highway and Thailand and Myanmar relationship. So many programs and seminar is taking place. The last one, this is the Nathula border. This one and this one is the Nathula border. How it is interesting to go to Nathula, see the infrastructure. And the next is, tourists are requested not to cross international border, but your natural resource can cross. You cannot control your river, you cannot control your mountain, you cannot control your air, or even you cannot control your product. So these 5 things can move or cross the border except human being. So human being is always deprived with other facilitation as compared to natural resource. Both the country, Thailand and Northeast India, is abundant natural resource. Let us cross the boundary and enjoy the benefit of our 2000 years old relationship. Because when you go to any other part of the world, you have to spend money. But simply you send one order, I want this brand of this product, it will be reached to your home by what you call it, e-marketing. There is no need to worry about that it will not come. It will come, and it will be cheaper as compared to the product available in the market. This is the Nathula business channel for India-China border trade. This is my area where I work. Whenever, at least once or twice in a year, I go to this border to just see what are the products they are sending or selling. Because in the paper, it is written only 18 items. But when I go to the shopping complex in the border, there will be 24 items. 6 items will be more. When I will ask the businessman, why you are selling 24 items? Only 18 are permitted. Sir, who is coming to check here? So that is why I am telling you, border has a different mindset and economy. It is necessary for them to sell whatever they have. So this is the opening of the market. These forces and these are the traders. They have given a symbol. This is the baton. So they will tell that, oh, today it is a start. It is only for 3 months market, not throughout the year, because it will be full of snow and minus 20, 30 degree temperatures. Nobody can go to survive there for 2 hours. And this is the Indo-China border trade, Sikkim. These vehicles will go, bring the product and come back to India side. So if you have any questions, I will be happy to
reply or conveys as according to my knowledge. So thank you very much, sir, for giving this opportunity.
Thank you very much for the insightful information. And we have learned something that we never know. We realize that the potential between India and Thailand is pretty huge.
Yes.
But the reality is still creeping up very small at the time. So any question from the floor, please?
Any question, query, observations, whatever you want.
Thank you for your presentation. In fact, I have, as he mentioned, I myself have not known about many facts that have been presented. But anyway, I would like to compare or ask you some questions about the strategy of economic development in India compared to Thailand. I wonder, you have mentioned that India before 1991, up to 1991, adopted the Soviet Union model. But in 1991, Soviet Union collapsed. I wonder, how did it affect the, you know, planning?
I will explain.
Yeah, okay. Secondly, when you talk about FDI, compare with Thailand, okay, I haven't heard the information about what kind of incentives in India to promote FDI after having, you know, adopted inward-looking policy for so many years and then followed by outward-looking. But anyway, I'm sure that India, just like Thailand, must have adopted a kind of protection and concessions in order to attract, you know, FDI. So my question to you is that, have you ever worked out the cost of foreign direct investment in India? Either in terms of, you know, concessions given to FDI, to, you know, the foreign investors, or the cost, the internal cost arising from the economic development strategy. The other part that I think I would like to mention is that when the economic crisis took place in Thailand, His Late Majesty the King wisely mentioned something which I think related to FDI. He mentioned that if we want to look at the benefit derived from FDI, we must pay attention to the concept of so-called domestic value added. I wonder, in India, has this concept ever been discussed? Now in Thailand, I'm pretty convinced, I myself now am not for FDI, because I think that the domestic, you know, value added would be very minimal in Thailand. Thailand has gone through so many decades now, we still offer many concessions to FDI. We should have eliminated a long time ago. So, you know, let's just, you know, these few questions that I may want to know more about India. That's something that did not, you know, mention in your presentation. Thank you.
So you have asked so many questions, I will briefly summarize all these things, because one question will take so long time. So 1991 was the collapse of Soviet Union or disintegration of the USSR. Internal compulsion for India to liberalize economy was twin. One is balance of payment crisis and second was high inflation growth rate. Soviet Union collapsed in the last quarter of the 1991. It was not during the first quarter. India started liberalization from the first quarter. Politically, it may be correct that they might be knowing that Soviet Union is going to collapse within few months. During those days, I was a student of master, so I never ever projected what is the meaning of collapsing a region. It is the Soviet Union. But later when I become a researcher, then I realized that every country of the world was knowing the fact that 1991, last quarter, USSR going to collapse, because as a student, I read foreign policy of Mikhail Gorbachev as well as Putin. So these things were keep in mind that how Mikhail Gorbachev, that is the glasnost policy, glasnost, how they are liberalizing the economy. So there was some indications by this economic reform that Soviet Union is about to collapse. There was indications through this policy reform. And when I got opportunity to work in USSR, that is the Five Republic of Central Asia, then I confirmed that entire world were knowing that Soviet Union is going to be collapsed very soon. This is the first-hand information I am giving you as a scholar. The second, you were asking about the incentives, what government of India is giving to the foreign investors. There is a list of incentives, and we generally revise the list that if you are coming with this much of value, you will get this much of facility, concessions, you will be treated like the common man of the country, there will be no any foreign, you know, things with attached to your name, you will be remain treated as a common man with some of the limited privileges. So when you read this liberal policy for foreign technology collaboration, policy supported by legal framework, it is legally supported by the court of law that is prevailing in our country, then national treatment to the investment, it will be treated equally like a national treatment. It will never ever be treated like international investment, so you have to bear huge cost. Unless or until you will never ever allow a investor to feel comfortable, feel a common man of the country, feel privileged, nobody wants to take risk. It is a money of a man who is coming to facilitate you through investment. You give them comfortable space and zone, protect their life and business and community. It is government first priority.
No tax holiday.
No, tax holiday will be there, depends upon the total number of, you know, total value of the investment. If your investment is this much, then you will get 5 years tax concession. Then your investment is this much, you will get 8 years of tax concession. So without it, these are the incentive. And tax concession is one of the incentive. Tax concession is only one incentive apart from the other incentive. You will be treated like a common man of the country because you are the investor in the country and you are basically protected. Your industry will be protected under the court of law of the particular country. So these are the some of the visible incentives, and there will be so much of opportunity cost for them. That is the hidden opportunity cost, which only businessman will share you. It is a government and business, not for the common man to understand. There are so many privileges given to the investors. And ceiling and routes for investment is constantly reviewed and liberalized. Your investment, entire business will be evaluated. They will not charge you any tax, but it will be evaluated annually or frequently whenever they feel. And Indian FDI liberal policy independently to be liberal and progressive. So ultimately, government gives a lot of incentive, includes tax exemption, including tax exemption. And the last one, you were asking about the domestic value additions. You know, in developing country, we generally do value additions, but we have never ever developed a mechanisms or systems through our domestic value can be added. We generally import the finished product. In the capital goods, you can assemble. In the capital goods, you can assemble. In the agri product food, you can package. But we never ever allow any value additions. So this is a matter of concern for both the country, India and Thailand, that how we can develop a mechanism, develop a management which can able to facilitate our people for value addition. Because these products are very, very sensitive. It is not a car or bus. You can ask, send me one tire, send me machine, send me wheel, and it can be assembled like China is doing. China is assembling their products in Philippines, in Malaysia, but not in Beijing or Shanghai, because the labor charge is very, very high in China as compared to Malaysia and Philippines. So we have to understand the labor cost and labor policy, wage policy of the particular country. If the wage policy is very, very less as compared to your own country, it is better to send them to get maximum growth. Sir, trade and investment is a matter of profit. If you do not see any profit, people do not involve. Ultimately, they are the profit maker, and profit has to become under the shadow of the government or outside the shadow of the government. But they need protection as well. That is why entire Japan, China, Malaysia, Singapore, then Philippines, these are the network of assembling area. I visited some of the assembling area, but when I discussed with the Chinese businessman, they told me that why I need value addition in my own country if I am getting cheaper product from the Malaysia, the labor is very, very cheap. Why I should keep busy in doing a small profits? So it is better to get finished product, ready to sell, ready to cook, not ready to wait. There is no need to worry about weight. Everything is ready to consume. So you can maximize your commodity value in the market. If it is ready to wait, who is going to wait? Because weight also needs some money. Weight needs some cost. Waiting charges, we have seen in the sea route that if you wait for one day, your container will be charged $100. If it is 20 days, $2,000 will be charged for waiting the container. Ultimately, the cost of the value addition will be less as compared to the total cost of traveling. These are the things one can understand. So this is what I can say.
Any other question? If not, I have. According follow up from what you said, despite the fact that all index that you have shown convince us that the potential between trade India and Thailand in terms of trade and investment is very high, I have two small questions. Why don't we have, let's say, at least the trade and investment from the diaspora of each country with each other? For example, we have very rich Indian businessmen in Thailand.
Yes.
They're extremely rich. Yeah. Why don't they go back to invest in India? On the other hand, since we have Thai races in Assam and somewhere else in Northeast India, so the cost of us in terms of culture is supposed to be very low. Why don't we go there to invest or to trade?
Cost of investment or cost of travel?
You
are asking about the Northeast India?
Yes.
Cost of travel will be less.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is my last question, I give a small answer from my own curiosity, whether or not because our political economy between two nations, that creates a lot of burden for both of us. For example, Indian businessman in Thailand do not invest in India because Indian government do not give them the same treatment as other people, or Thai government do not allow Indian businessman in Thailand to go there.
So let me react over your
all the three questions very briefly. You are talking about that Indian origin people in Thailand is not interested to invest in India. It is partly correct and partly not correct, because it depends upon the attitude of a particular individual, not business as a community. That if I am specializing in selling a particular product which India doesn't have demand, why they will go and sell there? So I talked to some of the businessmen in Thailand who is Indian origin. They prefer to sell South Sudan rather than Northeast India, because sometimes when you are connecting with your own family, you feel that it is not good for me to cheat them. Businessman is the best cheater of the world.
I am telling you bluntly,
because you cannot cheat your own people.
Yeah.
You can cheat the third person.
Yeah.
You cannot cheat at your home and neighbors.
Yeah.
So they do not want to cheat their own people.
So that's what we have in common.
Yes.
Yes.
The next one is, diaspora has two types. One is Indian born people in Thailand by residence, and one is Indian origin people who is settled before so many years back. So feelings of the two types of diaspora will be different. If their generation is surviving here, so they are the man of the Thailand. They are not man of the India, because everybody has migrated from one to another places. Unfortunately or fortunately, I am born in Bihar and still in Bihar. Okay? But everybody has born from one place and migrated to other place. So they do not want to come back. I have given you a example of Mauritius diaspora investment in India. Since last 35 years or 30 years or minimum 25 years, as I remember, government of India has given or provided level playing field for the Mauritius investor, particular then general, because you have to understand what they expect from your country. You do not interact with them frequently, there will be information gap or what you call social gap or emotional gap. Emotional gap has to be finished within these two countries. Everybody will come to meet some of the old friend. So our Mauritius Prime Minister and New Zealand ministers, they often come to their own home in Uttar Pradesh. They are the Prime Minister of Mauritius, Anirudh, but he will be happy to go as a common man of India. He doesn't want any protocol. Ultimately, it is affection and sentiment connect people, that you are no more a PM of India. PM in India is Narendra Modi, not Anirudh. Ultimately, this is his own soil. He can rule in Mauritius, not in India. In our country, he is a common man. So ultimately, what Thailand government has to connect with the diaspora, wherever they are. Thailand people have also located in different parts of the country. It is not only in India, but rest of the world. Government has to start a policy to attract, connect, and also request, please come back to your own country, not by food, but with money. There is no need to come back to country. You can transfer money. Money doesn't need any road transport or air transport or sea road. You can click button, money will come. we will handle money here. So you need money to invest and pump in the economy, which is generated by the Thai diaspora in the world. And once you connect through a policy and program, it should be readable for the entire world. Government of India has a ministry for this. Please remember, we have a ministry for Indian diaspora under Ministry of External Affairs, and they conduct program every year, once in a year at least. The venue will be changing, so there will be 5,000, 10,000 Indian diaspora will come to speak. I am interested to invest in this sector. What are the incentives you are going to give me? So it is a cross cultural exchange between these two people. You will get, not today, but tomorrow. We should be optimistic about it. If you start the process to interact with them, invite them, give them level playing field, by 2020-25, you will get some of the investment from your diaspora as well. There is no any doubt about it. We have to trust our people, whether at home and outside.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your answer. I think it's about time. So
let me, you
have another question.
Please. This might not be specific to your presentation, but there is a prediction that in the year 2030 there would be the shifting of economic power from North America to Asia, because by then China and India combined will represent the new economic power of the world. Would you agree to this prediction?
Yes, I am agree. I have written in a book article with this word only. I have started my quotation given by one economist that by 2030 India and China will be dominating not only in Asia but in the entire world, because 21st century belongs to Asia only. 21st century belongs to us. We have to understand and remember. It is Asian country who will dominate over the world. How long US and USSR is no more. People forget USSR. So there will be time when we will forget US also. And we will remember only Asia and India finally. This is what I expect.
So we have about 14 years to study each other and then try
so
to get
that island would be
get,
one of them.
Yes.
To get the potential that we have.
Right. Mm.
So finally, I would like to ask Professor Supum to present the token of appreciation from the Faculty of Economics and the India Studies Center to Dr. Pasqua.